In this video, I'll demonstrate the process of deploying a .NET Core web application on a Linux server. I'll be showcasing the deployment of a Blazor application throughout this tutorial. It's worth noting that the same approach can be used to deploy various applications such as MVC, ASP.NET Core web API, etc. I'll guide you through each step of the deployment process. Let's dive in. I have prepared a demo Blazor server app that we'll be deploying in this tutorial. Let's run the application to give you a preview of how it functions. This is a straightforward application featuring a welcome message on the homepage. We have also included a counter page where clicking the button will reveal the current count. Furthermore, there is a fetch data page that displays sample data in a table format. Now let's explore the deployment process for this application on a Linux server. Before we proceed, it's worth noting that we have a dedicated Blazor tutorial playlist where you can learn more about Blazor development. You can locate the link to the playlist in the video description below. So first, I'm going to initiate the publishing process. At this point, a window for creating the published profile will appear, asking for the target. I'll select the folder option as our target. If necessary, you have the option to modify the folder location, but I'll use the same location for publishing the files. Our published profile has been successfully created. Now, let's make some adjustments to the settings. I am opting for framework dependent in the deployment mode option. Under the target runtime, you'll find several choices for various operating systems. Since we are planning to host it on a Linux server, I'll select Linux-x64 as the target runtime. Once the settings are in place, let's save them and proceed with the publishing process. Visual Studio has initiated the building process. Our application has been successfully published. I'll now open the published folder. Within this folder, you can see the files that we need to copy to the server for deployment. To make our application accessible to the public, we require a public cloud server. In the video description, you'll find a link to the service provider I used for hosting. I have acquired a VPS server with Ubuntu Linux from the provider, granting me the root access to connect to the server. Let me copy the files from the published folder. Afterward, we'll upload them to the server using WinSCP. I'll establish an FTP connection to the server by providing the server IP, username, and password. I believe there was an issue with the password I initially entered. Let me try again. WinSCP has successfully connected to the server now. Next, I'll navigate to the var folder inside the root directory. Within the var folder, I'm creating a new directory named apps. Inside this apps directory, I'm creating another folder named demo app. Now, we can paste all the copied files into this newly created folder. All the files have been successfully copied to the destination. Now, I'll establish an SSH connection to the Linux server using an SSH client application. Once again, I'm providing the server IP for the connection. I'll be signing in as the root user. Also, let me provide the password to complete the login process. First, we need to install the necessary dependencies and services. Let's begin by updating the package index files using the apt-get update command. The update process has been successfully completed. Now we can proceed to install the ASP.NET Core runtime. Let's verify the installed version of the .NET runtime by using the command .NET --info. As you can see, it displays the current runtime version that is installed on our server. These instructions can also be found on the Microsoft website. The website provides the necessary commands for installing the .NET SDK and runtime. Moving on, let's install the Apache web server. To confirm that the Apache web server has been successfully installed, we can test the URL associated with the server. I have already directed blazordemo.codingdroplets.com to the server's IP, and you can see that it now displays a demo page. We'll be using this URL for our Blazor application. Before proceeding with the deployment, let's attempt to run our Blazor project on the Linux server. I'm navigating to the folder where we copied the files, which is located in /apps/demo-app. Here you can see all the files that we previously copied. Now let's go ahead and run the application. The application is now up and running, and you can observe that it's currently listening on port 5000. If desired, we can assign a custom port number. To do this, let's open the appsettings.json file. We'll need to configure Kestrel to listen on the desired port. I have specified that it should listen on port 8801. Now let me save the file. I'll now rerun the application, and this time you can see that it's listening on port 8801. Next, we need to register our application as a service and run it in the background. To do this, we must create a service unit file. We'll use WinSCP to create it. I'll navigate to the root folder, then etc, and finally systemd. Within the systemd folder, there is a folder named system. Here I'm creating a new file which we'll name demoapp.service. Within this file, we need to include various details about the service. First, I'm providing a description. Now, let's proceed to define the details of the service section. We'll start by specifying the working directory, which should be the same folder where the application files are located. Next, there is the xxstart directive, which specifies the full path and the required arguments for executing the command to initiate the process. I'm also including additional directives under the service section. Additionally, we should include the wanted by directive under the install section. This directive specifies the target unit that the service should be wanted by. In other words, when the target unit specified in wanted by is started, the service will also be launched as a dependency. So that's all we need in the service unit file. Let me save and close the file. From the SSH client, let's now attempt to start the service. The service has been successfully started. Let's also verify its running status. As you can see, the service is currently active and running. We can observe the console outputs indicating the application is listening on port 8801. I'm also enabling the service to automatically start during the boot process. With this step, we have completed the service implementation process. The next step involves creating a configuration file for the Apache web server. We need to ensure that any requests coming in from blazordemo.codingdroplets.com are routed to port 8801 locally. I'll create this configuration file using WinSCP. Let's navigate to the /etc/apache2 folder. Inside this folder, you'll find a directory named sites-available. Here, we can see the auto-generated configuration files for the demo site. I'm currently opening one of the existing configuration files. We'll need to create a similar kind of file for our application. But before we do that, let's disable the auto-created sites provided by Apache. To achieve this, we can utilize the a2dissite command. I'm trying to disable the second site as well using the a2dissite command, and it's indicating that the site is already disabled. Now, we can proceed to reload the Apache service to activate the changes. Let's proceed by creating a new configuration file named demo-app. I am opening the virtual host tag, and this site should accept requests from port 80. Next, we need to provide the server name directive to specify the host name or domain name that client will use to access this virtual host. We'll also include the directives necessary for the reverse proxy. These directives will ensure that the requests are forwarded to port 8801. Additionally, I'm including the proxy pass reverse directive, which is used to adjust and rewrite HTTP response headers received from the application. That's all we need for our site configuration file. You can now see the new file that has been created in this folder. Next, we can utilize the a2insite command to enable this site configuration. We must reload the Apache service to activate the changes. Now you can see that it's displaying a message indicating that the Apache service failed to load. If we check the status of the Apache service we can observe the control process exited message in the logs. This occurs because we need to enable a few modules in Apache to use the reverse proxy. I'm using the a2nmode command to enable the necessary modules including proxy, proxy HTTP, proxy balancer, and lb method by request. Now, let's restart the Apache service. When we check the status now, you can see that the service is active and running. Let's move to the browser window and refresh the page. Now you can see that the URL is correctly loading our Blazor application. We can also navigate to the counter page and by clicking the button displays the count. Furthermore, the fetch data page is showing the values in tables. In conclusion, we have successfully demonstrated the deployment of a Blazor application on a Linux server, covering each step in detail. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And as always, the link to our dedicated Blazor tutorial playlist can be found in the video description, where you can continue your journey in the world of Blazor development. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next tutorial.